Welcome to Chalice Unitarian Universalist Congregation. We are a community of diverse beliefs and experiences, nurturing the liberal religious spirit and united by our desire to grow in love and in service. Give me a second because something is echoing in my room. Thank you. Whoever you are, whomever you love, whatever your life's journey, you are welcome here. Whether you gather with us every Sunday, once or twice a year, or are here online with us this morning for the first time, we are glad you are here. I'm Reverend Sharon Wylie, Chalice's minister. Our worship musician this morning is Justin Gray. Our song leader is Amy Throckmorton, and our audio-visual technician is Stuart Holmes. Welcome to this online worship service. So let me orient you a little bit to this experience. Whether you have a microphone or not, or a camera or not, you are muted and invisible and cannot change that during our time together. And because of all that, you don't need to worry that anyone can hear you or see you. So kick back in bed with your coffee and enjoy the service. If you get a notice that pops up during the service that says internet unstable, that means that your internet is unstable. If that happens, you might want to turn off any other devices you have using Wi-Fi in your home to help stabilize your connection. If my internet becomes unstable, or if Stuart's internet becomes unstable, or if Zoom crashes, these are things that have not happened to us yet on Sunday morning. But those are the things that could disrupt our worship. And that's just how it is. So try not to be too stressed or upset if that happens. Just hang in for a while and we'll see if we can get it fixed and get back on track. So this is me greeting you on our courtyard, standing at the door of our chapel. Since I can't hug you myself, please give yourself a big hug of hello from me. And if you're at home with someone else, go ahead and give them a hug too. Even if you're together all day long every day, sometimes we forget to reach out to the other people in our homes for hugs. So on your menu, as many of you know and have found, you have a button that says chat. This is where we talk to each other during the service. And so I'm going to put in the chat a link to our online connection card. If you're new to the congregation, give me a second. There we go. If you're new to the congregation and you'd like to get on our email list to receive email announcements, you can fill out that online connection card to add yourself to our email list. Then you'll get regular updates about the other things we have happening on Zoom and how to connect with those. Also, if you're a regular attendee at Chalice and you have a question you would normally submit on a connection card or any change of contact information, you can use that link as well to fill out a connection card. I'm also going to put into the chat my email address. There we go. If you would like to submit a prayer request to me or you have any confidential information you'd like me to know, these are things you can email to me and I'll read them privately after the service. So now's the time for us to open up the chat box all together if you haven't, and I'll remind you as I do every Sunday, and I love that I see more and more of you correcting yourselves when this happens. When you post in the chat, you need to make sure that you've opened the little blue menu to select all panelists and attendees. If you only post to panelists, only Stuart and I see your message and we're busy and it's hard to reply once the service starts. But if you post to panelists and attendees, then everyone sees your message, which is what we want. So we'll go, we've already been greeting each other, but let's go ahead and do that to some music. And if this is your first time with us, let us know, and let us know where you are this morning if you feel like it. This morning, we invited the Shepherd Holmes family to light the chalice. Thank you. Our call to worship comes from the Reverend Gretchen Haley. Give up the fight for some other moment, some other life than here and now. Give up the longing for some other world, the wishing for other choices to make, other songs to sing, other bodies, other ages, other countries, other stakes. Purge the past, forgive the future, for each come too soon. Surrender only to this life, this day, this hour, not because it does not constantly break your heart, but because it also beckons with beauty, startles with delight, if only we keep waking up. This is the gift we have been given, these body clothes, this heartbreak, this pulse, this breath, this light, these friends, this hope. Here we remember ourselves, all a part of it all, giving thanks and centering joy. Let us worship together. Please join in singing. If you have a sorrow you would like to share with the community this morning, now is the time to share it in the chat box. We won't share these out loud, but please feel free to respond to each other in the chat. This is our time for sorrows. We'll share joys a bit later on. We'll listen to some piano music, and if you have a candle in your own home you would like to light, this is a good time. Thank you. May our sorrows be lessened. May our burdens be lightened. In sorrow and challenge, may we know ourselves always held and never alone. May we act to extend our warmth to all who are hurting in our wider world. And now, a story. The Rhino Who Swallowed a Storm by LeVar Burton and Susan Schaefer Bernardo, illustrated by Courtney Fletcher. This version is abridged. Long, long ago, before there were words, animals roamed in bountiful herds. Little rhinoceros lived happy and free, exploring mountains and meadows, rivers and trees. His world was delightful and chock full of magic, until out of the blue, the magic turned tragic. A storm swept through the valley, turning bright sky to black. A flash flood came raging, no time to react. Lost in the thundering, no time for wondering. Chaos and lightning, fury so frightening. Earthquaking, him shaking, water rumbling, him tumbling. Raggedy, jaggedy, senseless calamity. The storm crashed through his world and tore it apart and took away everything dear to his heart. Rhino was stunned by the terrible scene, death and destruction all through the ravine. Enraged by the pain of such a great loss, Rhino acted without a thought to the cost. Rhino looked at his world all tattered and torn, stood out on a ledge, and swallowed the storm. Inside his belly, he felt the storm growing. Inside his head, he heard howling and blowing. Like a tornado, he spun as the storm raged inside, growing bigger and bigger and wider than wide. When he finally stopped, when he regained control, he was at the very bottom of a very deep hole. What to do? Rhino worried as rain dripped down his face. I'm lost and I'm lonely and in such a dark place. At just the right moment to comfort and guide him, a spider dropped down and dangled beside him. The world up above is shattered and gray, but it's where you belong, so you must find a way. To let the storm out and move through your sorrow, you'll find many helpers on your road to tomorrow. Oh, but that hole was dreadfully deep, and the walls all around him were slippery steep. Rhino tried to climb out, but was losing all hope, when Kangaroo heard him and threw down a rope. Though Rhino was heavy from the weight of the storm, they towed him right up, got him safe, dry, and warm. We're strong and steady and always ready. When danger strikes, we hop to it. Fire or flood, snow or mud, when help is needed, we'll pull you through it. Watching those heroes do what they did best gave Rhino the strength to set off on his quest. That storm he was clutching made him buzzy and blurry. It kept his brain foggy and filled him with worry. Where do I go? What do I do? How will I ever make it through? After every dark night, there comes a new day. Be kind, do your best, and you'll find your way. Up comes the sun. There are steps to complete. There isn't a map. Just follow your feet. Rhino followed his feet to a wallowing spot where he plopped on a rock and had a deep thought. I'm tired of caging the wind and the rain, exhausted from holding this anger and pain. We're all on this earth to learn and to grow, a wise old tortoise chimed in from below. Allowing yourself to start feeling your feelings is the very first step on the journey toward healing. It doesn't much matter if you're fast or you're slow. If you want to move forward, just trust and let go. Rhino shook and shimmied and stomped in the muck. And just as he hoped, that storm came unstuck. At first, one little raindrop leaked out of his eye. Then Rhino let go and had a good cry. His tears formed a river that flowed to the sea, where a pod of whales swam happy and free. I do feel better, Rhino thought as he drifted. Then up swam a whale, and Rhino was lifted. If you ever feel blue, the whale said with a spout, remember to breathe. Breathe in and breathe out. Sing your own song and take it deep, deep, deep. Then rise above with a joyful leap. As he floated home on a gentle wave, Rhino felt calm and strong and brave. His vision was clear like the sky above, and he looked at his world through eyes filled with love. He thanked the kind spider and the brave kangaroo and all of the others who'd helped him through. He was glad to know that if he ever lost hope, they'd lend him a hand or throw him a rope. He had journeyed his journey a very long way to find the light in a world turned gray. He swallowed a storm with no thought to the cost. He'd felt all alone, he'd been tumbled and tossed. Life would bring changes, beginnings and ends, but he had faith in himself and faith in his friends. As they curled up together, he felt loved and protected, and he dreamed of a world that was safe and connected. He understood now it was love that mattered. Love could never be lost. Love could never be shattered. The end. Our reading this morning is an excerpt from an article called How to Salvage a Disastrous Day in Your COVID-19 House Arrest by Aisha Ahmad, an assistant professor of political science at the University of Toronto. Most of us have completed a full month of physical distancing, working and teaching from home in the wake of COVID-19. As we settle into this new reality, many of my colleagues are questioning whether they are faring better or worse by this stage. Some are excitedly doing yoga, baking bread, and writing papers. Others have hit a wall and are crying into a bag of potato chips. A month into it, are we improving or failing at crisis adaptation? Having lived and worked under sustained disaster conditions in many places, I can assure you that that question is ridiculous. Crisis adaptation is not a linear upward trajectory toward productivity and happiness. In fact, measuring your adaptation success by these metrics can leave you discouraged and stuck. That is especially true if you had a string of good days early in the crisis, then got hit with a series of train wrecks. In the midst of this catastrophe, you may experience disruptions of your sleep, appetite, work, fitness, and family life. Some days you will wake up in a fog. You will wander around in your pajamas, and when you look up from your phone, it will be 3 p.m. You'll have accomplished nothing and have missed your breakfast and lunch. Work and family commitments will be clawing at you, and you may start to panic. Take heart. It is absolutely possible to salvage a disastrous day, even if you are in a multi-day slump. It is inevitable that everyone will have both good and bad days over the course of this pandemic, and it is absurd to compare the peaks and troughs. The sensible approach is to ride the wave and work cooperatively with the psychological challenges that each day presents. Let's join in singing. Thank you. I've preached on grief before. I've preached on coping with the unwanted surprises in life. I've preached on coping with change. But what's extraordinary about this particular time, one of the things that's extraordinary, is that we are all of us going through it together. Not just some people impacted, but all of us impacted. And all of us impacted, not just for a little while, but for however long it takes to develop a vaccine, which looks to be quite a while. So let me say that more clearly. I think it unlikely that we will be able to worship in person together until a vaccine is developed. So let's take a breath together. We're coping with a lot. We're coping with a lot, but we're not all coping with the same fears or the same restrictions. It's a strange thing to be going through something together, but each of us will be going through it in our own way. Those of us with chronic illnesses have a lot more experience than the rest of us with what it's like to live with limitations, what it's like to have to stay at home when we don't want to, and what it's like to consider our own mortality. Some of us are enjoying having less to do, fewer obligations, and no place to go. Some of us are working full-time or even more than full-time. And the challenge there is that life feels almost normal, but it's not quite normal. And of course, the news is always lurking, intruding. Some of us are worried about our loved ones. Some of us are worried about ourselves. Some of us have young children at home full-time now. Some of us have adult children at home full-time now. And you can go along with things feeling mostly fine until they suddenly don't feel fine at all. And the day is hard, and staying in front of the TV in pajamas seems like the right thing to do. And for that day, that is the right thing to do. You'll think, why was that day so much harder than the other days? And there might be no reason. It's just that we're coping the best we can, and some days our coping is better than others. That's just how it is, and that's how it's going to continue to be. Here's what's actually hardest, in my opinion. Your coping will have no routine, no predictable timeline. It won't make sense. As we heard in our reading, crisis adaptation is not a linear upward trajectory toward productivity and happiness. And so the most useful tool in your toolbox is your own self-awareness. And you'll need it relentlessly, endlessly. There's no coasting. The answers that are right for one person aren't right for everyone. The answers that are right one day won't be right the next day. You need to be in tune with your own feelings, your own history, and your own self. And that relentless, endless need for self-awareness is why you suddenly feel so tired. It's tiring to have to discover and rediscover yourself. I was exhausted this past Monday and grouchy, and I just watched TV and stayed on the couch. It's what I needed to do that day. I kept thinking, well, I should do some laundry. I should balance the checkbook. But I didn't want to, and so I didn't. By the early evening, I started to feel a little better, more like myself. And after that, I had a pretty good week, actually, all things considered. When I reflect on it, I think part of it is that Monday is my day off. Monday is the day I can have a grouchy day and watch TV and lay on the couch. I think my spirit needed rest and just kind of waited until it was the right time. But if day after day was laying on the couch watching TV, then that would be the time for serious self-reflection. What's going on? Of course, this isn't going to be the most productive time of our lives, but we are going to be at this for far too long to simply wallow the whole time. We will need to make some kind of effort at living. Our story today, The Rhino Who Swallowed a Storm, is a story about the importance of feeling our feelings. Letting ourselves feel our feelings, whatever they are, grief, anger, fear, sorrow, feeling our feelings is one of the most important things we can do. Now, we're going to be living in a coronavirus world for quite a while, and we can't let our negative feelings immobilize us. All important spiritual work involves finding a balance between competing values. And this work is to feel our feelings without becoming overcome by them. This is where a daily spiritual practice will come handy. I encourage you to nurture a daily practice: prayer, meditation, journaling, mindfulness. You want to nurture a practice that helps quiet the mind, which will then help you process your emotions. Our minds keep working to keep us from feeling, recognizing what we're feeling. So you want a daily spiritual practice that will quiet the mind, which will also help you process your emotions. We shared our sorrows earlier in the service, and now it's time for our joys. If you have a joy you would like to share with the community this morning, you can share it in the chat box. Feel free to respond to each other there. This is our time for joys. We'll listen to some piano music, and if you have a candle in your own home that you would like to light, this is a good time. Thank you. May our joys be multiplied. May we act to extend our warmth to all who are rejoicing in our wider world. The Sunday offering is an expression of the generosity that makes our congregational life possible. As Buddhist teacher Christina Feldman writes, generosity lies at the heart of spiritual practice. Extending generosity to ourselves and others gladdens our heart, is a direct way of healing division, and brings joy. Please text your donation to Chalice. If you haven't texted a donation before, know that once you text the amount, you'll get a reply with a link to follow to enter your credit card information. And then once you've entered that the first time, you won't need to enter it again. And you can make a text donation anytime, not just on Sunday morning. The phone number will be on screen in a moment, but I'm also going to put it in the chat box. Please give generously. Please join in dedicating our offering with words of affirmation. May love be the spirit of this church. May the quest for truth be its sacrament and service be its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge in freedom, and to help one another in fellowship. This is our aspiration.
Mother cannot guide you, now you're on your own. Only me beside you, still you're not alone. No one is alone, truly, no one is alone.
Sometimes people leave you way through the wood. Others may deceive you. You decide what's good. You decide alone.
But no one is alone.
I wish.
I know. Mother isn't here. She'd say,
who can say what's true?
Nothing's quite so clear now.
Do things, fight things.
Feel you lost your way.
You decide, but you are not alone.
Believe me.
finger. Say the slightest word, something's bound to linger. Be heard. No one acts alone. Careful, no one is alone.
People make mistakes.
Fathers,
people make mistakes. Holding to their own,
thinking they're alone.
Honor their mistakes.
Everybody makes
one another's terrible mistakes.
Witches can be right.
Giants can be good.
You decide what's right.
You decide what's good. Just remember. Someone is on your side.
Our side.
Our side. Someone else is not. While we're singing our side.
Our side.
Our side. Maybe we forgot. They are not alone.
No one is alone.
Hard to see the light now.
Just don't let it go. Things will come out right now.
We can make it so.
Someone is on your side. No one is alone.
Not sending words yet. There have been a lot of jokes on social media about drinking during quarantine. And of course, we need to laugh when we can. And I want to say a quick word about the difference between distraction and numbing. We absolutely need to find sources of enjoyment and pleasure during this time. We need things that can distract us from the bad news and take our minds off whatever is troubling us. We're going to watch TV and read books and listen to music and play video games. And for those of you who drink alcohol, you're going to enjoy a glass of wine or beer or a cocktail from time to time. All of these things that are enjoyable can become harmful when they are used to excess. When they are used to make us numb and keep us disconnected from our feelings and from other people. So I want to make sure you hear that. Everything that is enjoyable can become harmful when it is used to excess. And how we judge is if something is harmful is that we recognize when we are doing something to make us numb and keep us disconnected from our feelings and disconnected from other people. So our work is to stay self-aware of whether our behaviors have crossed the line from just being an enjoyable distraction into something that is numbing our emotions. This is a marathon we're running. It's not a sprint. We need to cultivate behaviors that support our well-being and try to minimize the behaviors that don't support well-being. So a final reminder, now that we're several weeks into this, we sent out an email in mid-March asking if you'd like a check-in buddy for daily or every other daily phone calls. I just wanted to remind you that we're still happy to pair people up who are looking for that ongoing check-in time. I've heard good things from those of you who have a check-in buddy. So you can contact Judy Wynn if you're interested in being paired with someone, and we'll put a reminder about that in this week's e-news along with Judy's contact information if you don't have it. So remember, you are not alone. Let's take a breath together Now our closing words. May you go forward knowing that life is fragile and a gift, that you are lovable and loved, and you are not alone. Love and blessings to each one of you. I hope you will join us after the service at Coffee Hour, and we'll put a link to Coffee Hour in the chat box. Please join in singing.